welcome. Great turnout. Thank you for being here. This is so exciting. Welcome to the Oregon Advanced Strategy and Leadership Symposium. We are very excited to put this on today. Just a little bit of background. The Advanced Strategy and Leadership Symposium is about built around the idea that our MBAs, we have four centers. We have an entrepreneurship center, we have a finance center, we have a sustainability center, and we have a sports marketing center. And the idea was is to get to the C-suite, to be CEOs, to be the leaders of the next generation, you really have to understand all four centers. You really can't do it with just vertical knowledge about one thing. So we put this together, this specialization, advanced strategy and leadership specialization, so it can be transcribed onto the graduate school records. That's how it all got started. My name is Michael Crooke, and I'm an Avamere Professor of Practice here at the business school. And I really love my job. Myself and John Hull really kind of put this advanced strategy certificate together, and really this is the culmination of it. And thanks to the Papé Group, we were able to fund it to be able to put it on this year so that you'll be able to see the presentation that you're going to see. One of our speakers, Scott Kerslake, is in San Francisco at the airport right now. It turns out that they only have two runways, as most of you probably know. One of them has a pothole in it. So he won't be here tonight. So I'll actually fill in doing a presentation. The order of events for this evening will be, first we'll have a video opening up the symposium. Then we will have our dean, Sarah Nutter, will come up and introduce the president of the university, who will say a few words. After that, David Higdon from NASCAR and Jordan Papé will both do a 15-minute presentation, as well as I will, based on customer engagement. The theme of today is really, you know, things are changing so much, but as much as they've changed in terms of customer engagement, they've also stayed the same. What are the values that really drive a customer to be loyal? That's what we're going to talk about. And we're going to talk about it in three completely different industries, from industrial sales to clothing to NASCAR. So what will be the connective tissue? The idea is we do 15-minute presentations, we take a short break, we come back, and we have a discussion with the audience. So you'll be able to ask the questions that you want to ask. That being said, let's get the show on the road. Ian, can you start the video, please?
I'm Jordan Papé, CEO of the Papé Group and member of the fourth generation in our family business. While our products fall under equipment sales, at the core, we are a people business. For over 75 years, the Papé Group has been dedicated to maximizing our members' talents to deliver consistent, quality customer service. My father, Randy Papé, believed deeply in this customer service-driven ethic. It is critical that we keep an open dialogue with the next generation of business leaders to better understand their business outlook. We're pleased to partner with the University of Oregon Lundquist College of Business to gain a deeper understanding of generational values, future trends, and how we can position our business to meet the needs of the West's future leaders and decision makers.
The keystone to great marketing is to make someone feel more of themselves, whether that means telling a great story that someone can relate to or showcasing something someone is aspiring to. It's really all about connecting with people and making sure that they feel part of what either your business, product, or service is all about.
The sustainability has a huge sway when targeting and positioning products to consumers. And a big example from our generation is shoe companies that give back to others in developing countries to help make sure everyone has access to a basic product. And I think that consumers and millennials like myself really bought into that concept more than they did the actual product. To me, sustainability is really about having diverse opinions in order to sustain a company. Working through this helps the bottom line of the company because there's a lot less attrition and people actually want to work for a company that values their opinion.
Companies have an obligation to maintain a high standard of ethical financing decisions in order to achieve success. As I enter into the world of finance, I want to make sure that I hold myself to that same standard in order to help those companies build long-lasting legacies.
I don't think there's an exact formula to be an entrepreneur, because if you look at the successful men and women that have been in business, they all have something a little bit different. But I think what they brought to the table is they brought their essence, their authenticity, and they really were able to zero in on what the consumer wanted and what lacked in the world. And I think the other trait, though, is tenacity. You have to be able to do this every single day without a cheerleader saying that you're doing the right thing. So it's being able to walk that journey by yourself sometimes, not just in front of a crowd that's patting you on your back.
Welcome to the 2017 Randy Papé Oregon Advanced Strategy and Leadership Symposium. We are honored to have with us keynote speakers David Higdon, Scott Kerslake, and Michael Crooke. Here, we will have the opportunity to discover the business concepts and outlook for the 21st century. Join us as we analyze the collaborative role of entrepreneurship, marketing, finance, and sustainability, and how these can be used to a competitive advantage. Go Ducks!
Lights up.
University a little longer ago than I did. It's now officially 21 months ago. And in that 21 months, he's already accomplished a great deal. Some of the things that he's had to tackle right immediately are things like prosaic issues, like budget issues, and things like that. But at the same time, he's really stepped out on what I'm going to call some bold initiatives. The initiative that we have now with the College of Applied Science is part of the reason I came. I came to this university at this moment in time because I think we're at a pivotal moment. And so this video that you just saw, where you link together all of those things, sustainability, marketing, finance, entrepreneurship, in today's environment, you can't just have one discipline. You've got to be sort of a systems thinker and think across that entire spectrum. This man does that amazingly well. And so it is my privilege to introduce our president, Michael Schill.
It's a real thrill today to be here. This is the first time I've been in the business school many times, but this is the first time where I've actually stood in front of an audience here and talked to people. Hopefully this will not be the only time that we go to sleep. But what I first want to say is I want to thank Sarah. Sarah, I am so excited about your dean. She is amazing. She is someone that was just back in my office saying, wow, Sarah's got it all. We were recently at, actually we were at the Final Four recently, and Sarah, I heard, was, you know, working the crowd until 2:30 in the morning. That's what you need as a dean. You need someone who will bring our alumni together, who will bring the community together. And I know Sarah, through her background and her success in her previous position at George Mason University, is going to take this school and move it really into the forefront of business schools. I think you're all very, very lucky to have her here. And I'm just excited as we move forward to see where the school can go. But today what we're here to do is to celebrate the Papé family, to celebrate and to learn about marketing, consumer relations, sports management, all of those topics, executive management, all of those things that are really deeply embedded in our school. And I never knew Randy Papé. I've talked to Susie quite a bit about him. I wish I did get to know him. I feel like I know him. And what I understand is the virtues that you're going to hear about today, the attributes of what makes a great businessman, what makes someone who not only is a genius of marketing, but also cares about customers, understands that the way to be successful is to have integrity and to be serving a set of consumers. That was Randy Papé. In addition, Randy Papé, along with Susie, and now their sons, soon their grandchildren, were the quintessential Ducks. They were committed, he was committed, Susie and family remain committed to this university, serving in leadership roles, many different leadership roles, from the foundation to advisory boards of the schools, and then beyond the University of Oregon, to the community, to the state, to making our university, making our state a really great place to live. And so we are really very grateful, both for what they've done for our university, for what they do for our university, but also for their example and what they mean to our entire community. And so with that, I'd like to hand it off to the panel, and we can then begin the program. But thank you. Thank you.
So we're going to get started, and Jordan is going to start, and he's going to do a 15-minute presentation. David will follow, and then I'll follow after that. Ian?
You said 50-minute presentations, 15.
Yeah. Probably sit one of these things out here.
This is a crowd that looks like it was promised pizza or something.
So just a quick one for to introduce you. Okay, so Jordan Papé is going to introduce himself, but Jordan and I first got to know each other a couple years ago when I asked him to speak in one of my classes. And he came and spoke in one of my classes, and it was supposed to be a half hour, 40 minutes thing, and turned into a couple hours because he was so willing to talk about some of the things you're going to talk about today. And we became friends, and he came the next year after that, and then I asked him if he would come and do this. But you are in for a treat. Fourth generation leader of the Papé Group, and you're going to find out about customer engagement from the industrial sales side of things. Very, very different, and you'll find very interesting.
Thank you.
MC, before we get started, I want to sort of highlight how deeply Susie cares about you and the rest of the panelists. She's concerned those aren't hinged. Make sure that you actually won't fall on the floor. Thank you, Susie. The big details is my eye level.
They weren't hinged.
An unhinged executive presentation. This will be fun.
Details, right, Jordan?
Go ahead and kick it off.
Details matter. Thank you, Susie.
Yes.
Oh.
I gotta rewind it just a little bit. There you go. Well, we're off and running. First, I want to just say thank you for coming tonight. Sales was a passion of my father's. We have my brother Ryan here tonight, my older brother, my mother, my wife Carrie, my mother Susie Papé, who you heard mentioned. And as a group, we felt strongly to partner with the University of Oregon and the Lundquist College of Business to come together tonight and talk about sales. Nothing happens in business until something is sold. You don't have accountants working. You don't have taxes to pay to get the government working. Nothing functions in our society until somebody goes out and asks for the sale. So we're encouraged to have this presentation and talk a little bit about how we go about business. In the background, you're going to see a video that sort of represents our company, and I will do my best to sort of hit the points that our marketing department wants me to hit, but it will just be loosely going in the background. You know, step number one in any business, if you're going to make a sale, you got to stand out. You got to be different. And for us, being different is in a dealership world. You got a lot of straightforward competitors, dealers of CAT, dealers of Freightliner, dealers of Toyota forklift. For us, it's about being the end-to-end mobile capital equipment solution. Right? That's a mouthful. What does that mean? That means we not only want to sell tractors and trucks, we want to provide entire solutions to our customers that allow them to take natural resources to final sale. So on the clips up behind me, you might see some forestry shots. That's at the roots of our company. So we want to be the ones to sell you the John Deere forestry equipment to harvest the tree. We want to sell you the log loader to put it on the Kenworth truck. We want to sell you the Kenworth truck that takes that log to the mill. We want you, once it gets to the mill, we'll sell you the Wagner single pass loader that will load the logs into the mill. And once it goes through the mill, we don't do any of the stationary equipment that turns the veneer into plywood or cuts the lumber. But when on the other side, we'll sell you the Hyster forklift to load the plywood and the lumber onto the Kenworth truck. And the Kenworth truck then takes it to a home building site, where maybe John Deere Construction Equipment is laying the road work with graders and dozers. Leeboy equipment is paving the roadways, and when it pulls up just in time to the pad where it can drop off the lumber, it'll get unloaded to build a home, and maybe out front there's a ditch-witch piece of equipment that's doing the underground work to lay the utilities, right? That's end-to-end solutions for us because our customers touch us in multiple ways. Same thing with agriculture. My brother Ryan runs the division on the agriculture side of the business. We sell John Deere Ag equipment. And we want to sell you the equipment to plant the seeds, sell you the equipment to harvest the crops, sell you the equipment to load the grain onto the Kenworth truck. The Kenworth truck takes it to a mill where it might become wheat, right? Up in the Palouse, our customers are harvesting wheat. And it goes from wheat to flour, flour to a bakery, and a bakery where it's made into bread on trucks and forklifts being moved around. And if you've ever had the experience of buying a loaf of bread off of a Costco rack, we sell all the racks to all the Costcos in the Western United States. So hopefully that went from grain to bread to Costco, all on solutions that we can provide. We get multiple touch points that way. That's how we set ourselves apart as different. Well, okay, so you got a business model. That makes sense. What makes a customer buy into us being part of their value chain? And it's exceeding expectations. The very first words that you saw in the video that was going at some point in time, was Papé keeps you moving. Papé keeps you moving is the promise that we make. So what does that mean? Our customers use our equipment to make money. If the equipment isn't running, they're not making money. So our first promise in keeps you moving is to represent brands that are the highest quality brands that are gonna provide the most uptime so that those customers can build homes, those customers can harvest crops, those customers can haul freight. But we all know equipment breaks down. So the dealer difference, what we choose to provide, is superior service. Through 2,500 members in nearly 90 locations, if a piece of equipment breaks down, our job is to get there quickly, repair it, and get them up and going so that they don't have downtime. Sorry. So they don't have downtime. So that's the service commitment. And then from there, Papé keeps you moving is through rental. Right? Through rental operations, if our customers have a fleet and they're out building homes or hauling freight, but their fleet is put to use on jobs that they've already landed. We can help our customers grow through our rental division, one of the largest rental fleets in the Western United States. That helps them grow, and then we hope that they reward us with helping their business with future sales. Well, that started all over again, so this will be a little bit interesting on how to hit some of the points, but how do you accomplish that? How do you, you know, this is fine textbook work. You could build a case study in and around how to try and put something like this together. But until you empower your people, and this is something that you all, as you're graduating from the University of Oregon, are gonna have to take ownership of, any leader of a growing enterprise wants to be able to empower their people to make the decisions as they're closest to the customer. My father used to talk a lot about the right side up and the upside down triangle. And you might experience this in the military, right? In the military, you've got the right side up triangle. Boss makes a decision, that decision flows down to the workers, work gets done, right? And in the military, it's necessary because if you don't follow the orders of your commander, people get hurt. That's not the way it is in tractors. That's not the way it is in a service enterprise. In a service enterprise, it's exactly the opposite, right? So you talk about an upside down triangle where you have leaders and family members who are helping to support our management team. Management team is supporting the supervisors who are closer to the customers who face, who are customer facing every day. And at the top of the upside down triangle, the big flat spot is what we would call the platform that our customers are supported with, right? So every day we're committed to creating that platform and empowering our people, those of you who are young and typically out and customer facing, empower you to make critical decisions and uphold the reputation of our business. Now, once you've got them supported, is it enough? That's another question. Can you just fulfill a customer's promise and provide them good equipment and try and keep it running and by doing the basic functions of your business, be successful? Maybe. But we like to believe that investing in customer relationships, deeper customer relationships, is what will draw them to come back to us over time. So what do? We invest in things like taking our customers to NASCAR, because it's exciting, more exciting than tractors. We take our customers to play golf. It's all of those things. And our signature event that you might hear about if you live in the area is the Willamette Country Music Festival. So Bi-Mart is the title sponsor, and we're the presenting sponsor, and that's a place where we take a couple hundred of our customers and their families, because you can make a deeper connection with a customer and their family, out for 4 days to RV camp and listen to phenomenal country music. I clearly do not look like the kind of guy that does a lot of RV camping. That is true. My wife will vouch for it. But it is a favorite time for our families. We go out and spend time together. When we build those deeper relationships, when NASCAR helps us create a bond with a customer, why is that important? Well, in a multi-division business like Papé, our goal is that when the time comes that we don't come through, when we fail to exceed expectations, that customer will pick up the phone and call our member that they have the close relationship with to say, this didn't pan out right. I wasn't treated fairly. You didn't fulfill your commitment. And I feel like you're not upholding the Papé keeps you moving commitment, right? Well, the first thing that's gonna happen is, say they call the ag division and they say, because that's where they have the relationship, the first thing that's gonna happen out of the ag division is they're gonna call the trucks division and say, you've got a really unhappy customer. And before I lose them as a customer, you better go fix it. And that becomes our learning opportunity. We get better with the mistakes that we make. And the customer feels like by investing in fixing the problems that we cared enough about them and the relationship to bring them back into the business. And the truth is, and I'm sure you've been taught this in your classes, it is much less expensive to retain a customer than it is to go out and acquire a new customer, right? So that gives us, through multiple touch points and great relationship building, the ability to bring these customers back again and again and continue to grow our market share in equipment in the West. The future, we had some cool slides about future technology and tractors. I'm sure you've been at the edge of your seat to hear about technology and tractors. It is, for us, very interesting. In my father's generation and my grandfather's generation, when they would go to major equipment shows like Con Expo, which was held earlier this year down in Las Vegas, it was all about, the technology was all about the bigger piece of equipment, the stronger engine with more horsepower that could pull freight further. Now it's all about technology. You have to be extremely sophisticated to understand all of the different technology inputs into a piece of equipment, because that equipment is then sending signals to our shop to help tell them when the equipment is running hot, maybe it's got an oil leak, and our goal is to tell our customer that they've got an oil leak before the engine freezes up, right? So we get those heads up and they can solve a problem when it's a $10 fix instead of a $10,000 fix. So that's the way of the future. Connectivity, just like your banking relationships where you log into a portal and you have a relationship with a bank and you've got bill pay and you've got your account set up, you don't ever want to switch banks once your bill pay is set up, right? Same for us. We want to provide that same connectivity for our customers so that when they log in, they know what their typical parts order is. They know how to go in and research their invoices and get payments made and look up POs. So that's really the connectivity touch point that we get out of technology. And then last, I would leave you with the community service side. Once you build a business, you retain customers, and you figure out how to make profit with it, the key is really, how do you give back to your community? Our father and grandfather, frankly, had an expression, your community is like your bank. You can't take more out of it than you put into it. So along the West, in all of our 87 locations across 7 Western states, we're regularly telling our management teams, go out and invest in your community. Whether it's the little things, like buying a hog from a farmer whose child is in 4-H and promoting their program, to the bigger things that go all the way up into state politics and trying to make sure that you're engaged in trying to make a difference in your community and your customers see that. We're committed to being involved in those things. With that, I think I've probably come close to my 15 minutes.
Thank you, Jordan.
Sure. Thank you very much. You're up next. So
I think we're going to hold for questions until the end.
Yep.
We're at David's.
David's up next. Okay. David Higdon.
David's in charge of overall marketing and communications globally for NASCAR. Yep. And he's going to tell us a little bit about himself. But he's also been associated here with the University of Oregon with the Warsaw Center. He's on the board. He's actually chairman of the Warsaw Board of Directors. Big part of our experiential learning here at the university. And David Higdon.
Thank you, Michael. Thank you all for coming here. Thank you, Jordan, for inviting me to be part of what's going to be clearly an exciting night. Appreciate it. Susie, I appreciate you coming. NASCAR is very much a family business like the Papé Group. I have deep roots here in Oregon. As I was sharing with Susie, my father actually competed in the Olympic trials in 1964 and actually ran at Hayward Field several times when I was a little rugrat. And so it's part of my beliefs and it's part of what I feel makes me who I am. And that University of Oregon logo wouldn't be up there if it wasn't part of my DNA. So before we get started, I want to show you a brand spot on NASCAR, just to give you a little sense of how we position ourselves. Jordan touched on the importance across several levels of the value chain, and certainly the marketing, the positioning of your brand is critical to long-term and short-term success. So I'm going to run this for you. And I'll have questions immediately afterwards.
Wise men say only fools judge him, but I can't help falling in love with
So how many of you have heard of NASCAR before you walked in the room today? Put your hand up. All right, put your hands down. Now, what's the first word that comes to your mind when you think of NASCAR? Shout it out. Fast. Racing. What? Say it out loud. Come on, speak up.
Moonshine.
Moonshine. Tailgating. Daytona. Rex. Jordan came in with the Rex because of the pothole that kept Scott from coming here today. What else we got?
Ricky Bobby.
Ricky Bobby. Good. Keep going. I won't be offended.
Beer.
What? Beer. What else?
Energy.
Energy.
White trash.
What?
White trash.
I can't hear you.
White trash.
White trash. Good. What else? No, keep going. I can take them all, believe me.
Noise.
Very thick. Noise. Loud. Notice how I quickly went to the volume over here. Anything else?
Ads.
Good point. Crashes. Last one.
Families.
That's a good one to end on. Because as we showed here, NASCAR is actually a family business. I did not plant that guy. The Papé Group is a family business. Jordan is fourth generation. Bill France Sr. up there in the right started NASCAR in the 40s. His son then took it into the next stage in which NASCAR just boomed. His son, the grandson of Bill France Sr., is now the chairman of our company, along with his sister, who runs International Speedway Corporation, which is half the tracks. And her son, Ben Kennedy, is currently racing as a fourth generation like you, except he's going 180 miles an hour, and he's in Daytona right now filming an episode of American Ninja Warrior. So that's how things change. Bill France Sr. never could have imagined in a million years that the France family would build an enterprise that was so successful that a driver was able to cross over into mainstream media and have an impact the way that NASCAR has over time. So we talked about some of the things. I got a white trash. NASCAR fans just live in the South. My job is to myth bust. Here's the reality. Basically, the NASCAR fan is identical to the U.S. fan. Isn't that right, Andrew?
Yep.
Thank you, sir. It's a guy thing, right? Only guys like NASCAR. Proportion of females who are viewing our sport is equal to all the other leagues. We're old. We're not cool. We're not young. We're not attracting. You're millennials. But we're actually within a year of the average age of the population. So clearly I need to do a bunch of myth busting because the facts is what we rely on to sell, which is what Jordan touched on earlier. Because you ultimately need to go to your audience and show them the reality of what your brand is all about. So you can talk about it, you can represent it in videos, but ultimately to be successful today, you need a return on investment on anything you participate in. No CMO is going to jump into your brand, into your business, unless he can go up the food chain, into the ivory tower, and say, we are being successful. So we were talking about tractors earlier, and Jordan touched on the fact that companies like John Deere, like Caterpillar, come into our sport, and it's not necessarily just to have their name for brand purposes on the front of a car, or on a commercial, or on a fire suit. It's the relationships that they build. So one of these companies actually has been in our sport for 25 years, and they wouldn't be in the sport for 25 years unless they could convince the top people in the organization that it's worth it. And they found that the customer sales that they were able to make, selling tractors we're talking about here, went down, if you were in the NASCAR program, from 5 sales calls to 2. Is that money? That's big. If you're freeing up your salespeople to be able to make a sale in 2 calls as opposed to 5, you have a big, big advantage. So ultimately, that's why NASCAR leverages the fact that our sponsor loyalty is shown across all of the sports, all the other sports that you guys follow, basketball, football, baseball, people follow and stick with the brand. Our fans, our customers, will be loyal to a particular brand unlike anything else in sports. So if you're a Jimmy Johnson fan, what do? You drive past Home Depot and you go an extra 6 miles and you buy a wrench at Lowe's because you know that Jimmy Johnson is supported by Lowe's. You drink Coca-Cola instead of Pepsi, unless you're a Dale Jr. fan, and then you drink Mountain Dew because we're a messy sport. We actually allow a lot more brands into our sport. It's harder. It's like consensus building, right? Dean Nutter. It's hard. Consensus is hard, and doing things collaboratively is very hard, but NASCAR has kind of cracked that code only because we can provide value to anybody who comes into our sport. Anybody. And we can break down the myths, and we can make it so that it's something that they're successful in. So ultimately, our fans, our customers, will support a brand that supports the sport overall. So NASCAR is what I call a scale sport. If you saw the logos before, I've worked in golf, I've worked in tennis, I've worked in NASCAR. Who could tell me what makes all three of those sports, what's the commonality between those three sports?
They're all on TV.
What's that?
They're all on TV.
They're all on television, absolutely. Individual, yep.
Tournaments? Yeah.
Yep. What they don't have a hometown. They're like the circus. It is harder because we're only going to come into town once or twice a year. We do not come to Portland. We do not come to Eugene. Yesterday, last time I was in Eugene, I ran into two guys. One of them was wearing a Jimmy Johnson Lowe's jacket, and another guy was wearing a Tony Stewart Home Depot jacket. I thought that was pretty funny. That's what happens in our sport. They actually wear the brand. And ultimately, by scale, it means we can get a wider audience because of how broad we are and how many people we appeal to at several different levels. Now, one thing key here, and Sarah touched on that, was when Susie did, when she said television, is television used to be the be-all, end-all in sports. And as Jordan has had to adapt his business over the years, we've had to adapt ours. And we knew that we were going to be in trouble if we did not start moving in the digital and social space. So we actually bought the rights back. We had sold them to Turner. And we brought our digital operations in-house simply because we knew that the digital age was upon us. And it was important that we be playing in that space and having control of our own voice. So television is something where we're currently struggling with. As Michael has talked to me about, he's asked me, he calls me all the time and asks, what's up with NASCAR? Why are we doing this? How's this happening? We've been struggling a little bit in the TV ratings. And so we have had to do some things that made people uncomfortable within our company, which is drive tune-in, push people, more people. But what we're finding is that people are consuming our product differently. They're watching on television briefly, but they're also digesting on the phone. So our product has had to adjust to the way people are now consuming. And the fact is our website, 70% of the people going to our website now are going through those things that are sitting in your pockets. All right? So everything we've done and everything we do and how we change our brand and how we change our product and differentiate our product is with the mind that we're ultimately going to be seeing things through a little device, and the product needs to change with it, or else you will be left behind. And then, instead of busting myths, you're going to be reducing staff. Okay? So it's important that you always try to stay ahead without leaving your core fan behind. So I'm glad he said white trash, because ultimately, our sport has to struggle with this balance of growing and becoming more like the broader U.S., and yet our core base is ultimately that in which the sport was born in North Carolina. That imagery literally that you saw earlier was because that's how the sport started, as moonshiners driving across the state lines, and that's ultimately where a good chunk of our fans are born, and if we go too far, they'll let us know very loudly on social media. And we have an amazing tool called the Fan and Media Engagement Center, which will amplify it for us so we know. But we are obviously interested in keeping our fans and making sure they consume us in a different way. So this pie chart is our money slide. Because when we're competing against the NFL and the NBA, and we know people are going to consume those products, we'll tell them, we will tell any business partner that people come to our website and they actually stay. They don't just check the Golden State Warriors score and move on. They actually stay and consume our product for a longer period of time. That's important to John Deere. That's important to the people that work and our partners with Papé Group. It's important to Lowe's. It's important to Coca-Cola. It's important to Monster Energy. So again, that's one of the things is when you're out there selling, you just cannot go with a generic story. You have to be able to tell them what distinguishes you from something else. I had the distinct pleasure of spending time with your new dean today for an hour. And that was the common theme. What distinguishes this university from every other university? What distinguishes this MBA program from everyone? That's where we need to make sure that everybody who is considering an MBA knows where our values are and what we stand for. So that's why it's important for us to continue to tell the story and to continue to knock down the myths about our sport. Our sport does not have the luxury of being handed a Jordan Bell or being handed a Justin Jackson that is a star from the beginning. Our sport has to develop our own stars, which has made it very difficult because it's a star-driven business. But we know that. We've built programs like a Drive for Diversity program where we're bringing young people through. We now have combines where we're bringing young drivers through. Danica Patrick drives in NASCAR. People have an opinion one way or the other about Danica Patrick. At our combine a month or two ago, two-thirds of the drivers who were there were females. That is the ripple effect that she has. We are going to be the first gender-neutral major sport. Mark my words. 5 years from now, 10 years from now, 15 years from now, I do not know when it will happen, but it is going to happen. So our sport is not natural. You don't go out there and play it when you're 3 or 4. So we have to make sure that when we talk about it, that we make it relatable. And hopefully, this is another brand spot, and I'll end and turn it over to MC, my good friend. But hopefully you'll see how that resonates. And if not, let me know.
Want a race?
Tough two acts to follow here. I'll be brief. So I've really enjoyed the first two presentations, and I hope that this maybe pulls things together. But people love being fans.
And so this is just a short guide on being superheroes. I've done all kinds of things. I want to talk about a few different ones. I started in the Navy, in the SEAL teams. And the only reason I bring that up is because everything I think about, even as a young man, is about strategy. How do you get there? You know, what is the process to get there? Because there isn't any one way to get there. Great brands, great stories like this. You know, it's very difficult to have a two-generation family. It's almost impossible to have a three-generation family. Four-generation families just don't happen. Very, very, very rarely. How does it happen? Well, a lot of the lessons and what you're learning today, that's the reason. And it comes down to values. So, and strategy. So I started my career in the outdoor industry with a company called Yakima. Very strong values. Bikes, racks for bikes, skis, snowboards. All the stuff that we did, we were passionate about it. We built great product because we were building it for ourselves. My first CEO job was with Kelty, a backpack company. Sort of messed up, a big company had bought it, it was a public company. What did we do? We had to do a strategic planning meeting at 40 degrees below zero in Ely, Minnesota with our own product. In fact, and it was completely broke down. The tent poles snapped, the sleeping bags didn't work, the packs broke down. And we had to tell ourselves, do people really want to buy this junk? They didn't want to buy this junk. We had to recommit the product. So, you know, both presentations so far, the product or the service, just paramount. You can't do it without it. Pearl Izumi, my next CEO role. This was a company that had great product. 15 of the vice presidents had been in the Tour de France previously. 15 of them. Problem was they didn't know anything about business. So it was great product. There was tons of money put into the product. The marketing was unbelievable, but the company was bankrupt. You have to have four quadrants to a business, whether it's fourth generation or basically any long-term business. Same as with a university. You have to have the people. You have to have the systems. You have to have the right product, and you have to have the right finances. It all has to work together. So how do customers become loyal? They have to have a value chain, which has been discussed today, and the value chain has to fit very closely together. Every single primary activity that you do has to fit. You can't do anything where you're not adding value to your customer. If you do something that's not adding value to your customer, you have to ask, can someone else do it better? And if so, maybe I should outsource that. Do I have the right people doing that job? If I don't, maybe I need to get some new energy in that position. The value chain, it's key to everything. The value chain is every single activity that an organization does. Some brands, they're able to do it long term. And they do it in a way where they own the category. And I really believe that there isn't any tired brands or only tired brand managers. If you're a great brand and you're able to look ahead and see beyond the horizon and understand what's coming, maybe that black swan that you have to prepare for or whatever that you can't, but you have to be ready to be agile and to go after it, that's what you have to build into a company. You have to be able to pivot. You have to be able to see things. You have to be able to move. Maybe in the food industry, these are some of the brands. So how do they do it? They do something beyond the product and service quality or experience. What I've learned is it's about this emotional connection to a purpose. And the purpose is, Edgar Schein is one of the great academics around culture. And he talks about when something becomes a part of a culture that might last four generations, it's something where there's been external issues or problems. Internally, they've solved them. And then they're taught to the new people. That becomes the culture of the company, of the organization. Even as an individual, we go through the same process. Your culture, who you are, what your values are. It's based on those experiences, those failures, those successes, how they're adapted, and then the next situation, how you handle it. So it turns out, as customers, we want to be a part of something bigger, grander than what we are. We want to be attached to something that can go farther than what we can do on our own. And when we find that type of brand,
we lock onto it, and it becomes a part of us. It starts, at some point, with learning about a brand, or a story, or a company. And to get to the next place, where you might buy the product, consume the product, be a part of the product, something happens in between. There's a series of messaging that goes on. Why do I show this letter? This is a letter from Warren Buffett to me, two sentences. When I took over Patagonia in 1999, we were for sale. And I pitched it to Warren Buffett, the company. And he wrote back this very nice note, no thank you, not interested, way too overvalued. And we had to figure out what was wrong. Why wasn't the company working? And so when you go back to this slide here, what we found out was between people finding out about the brand, there was a lot of people finding out about Patagonia, but they weren't going to buy the product. Why? Because we thought our values, the environment, was everything. It's all we talked about. It was our IFC, inside front cover, it was on the landing page, it was everywhere you look. The environment, the environment, the environment. Well, it turns out, I was doing a talk back east at a university. A young man came up to me and he goes, Dr. Crooke, I don't think you know your customer very well. This guy's like 22 years old. I said, oh, really? He said, yeah. I said, well, tell me a little bit more. He says about three or four sentences, and I just go, oh my God, this guy is way smarter than me. And I said, can we have lunch? And so we had lunch, and at the end of the lunch, I hired him. And he came to Patagonia, and he started doing these deep customer engagement studies. And what he found was the environment was the number four thing that people were interested in. The number one thing was quality. The fact that they could it was lifetime guaranteed, and it was quality. Number two thing was fit. Number three thing was color. And number four thing was environment. You have to find out what the messaging is to move people around the customer lifecycle curve. So in order to do that, you have to figure out what your story is. What is our story? What is our brand story? What is our promise to our customers? Well, we needed to do another study because organic cotton wasn't selling very well. So what we did was we started looking at all these different reasons for it and doing all these tests. And here's what we found. A customer will pay 10 to 11% more for the same t-shirt that's organic cotton if you tell the story well, why it's organic and why that's important. When we started telling people about the amount of pesticides and insecticides that went into one t-shirt, and even though organic cotton isn't that great either, there's a lot of water used, et cetera, what happens to the soil? We told the story really well, we could go up to 10% more with no change to the demand curve. Telling your story well. Who are you? What are your values? And how do you get those across to your customers? Loyal customers are up to 10 times or even more valuable than other customers for the reasons that we've articulated already. So this is the life cycle curve that we sort of developed. And so as you move people around from the prospects to casuals to loyals to advocates, here are the numbers we tracked through our catalog of people buying. Sometimes you could see up to 30 times more value for that customer if you told the story well and they delivered the message when they wanted to consume it. So thin slicing the data, understanding your customers, understanding what the message was a complete turnaround for our company. Complete. We turned the company around within a year very, very successfully. And we found out that these customers that we were selling to were cultural creatives. They were very authentic to what their values were. 60% of them were women. They did what they said. They weren't conservative and they weren't liberal. They were right down the middle, close to 50-50. Some people might find that unusual. Cultural creatives must be tree huggers. No, not at all. So, what about your story, your brand? I know there's a lot of different businesses in here. I can just look around, a lot of great businesses. Here's the deal. The best stories are authentic. You don't have to make anything up. you know, these are my values. Let me tell you about them. Let me really develop those stories. You know, Oregon, we have a great story here. We don't have to make anything up. We don't need expensive marketing companies to tell us what our story is. I grew up here. I know this place. This place is special. That's the story to tell. It's built on a contemporary set of values. And I would propose to you that these are the main values of our time for the 21st century. Financial strength. Without financial strength, it's over. It's game over. By definition, if you don't have strong financials, as we all know, you're a short-term company. You are not a sustainable company. Financials are key. How do you get strong financials? The product or service has to be super high quality. You have to stand behind it 100%. The social responsibility and CSR, as was mentioned with the community, if you're not connected to your stakeholders and your community, if you ask someone from a company, you say, hey, tell me about your company. You know, is that a good place to work? And they say, oh, this place is terrible. The benefits are terrible. They make us work long hours. They don't care about us. The boss doesn't know my name. I don't get any feedback. Guess what? That company is not going to be, you're not going to see that engagement through the selling cycle of the company. That's a keystone of a canary in the mine shaft. And environment. The environment's key. It's super important. It's a rising tide. I mean, global warming is real. You have to start to look at that and go, we're going to take that into account. And it doesn't matter what you do. By the way, there's no sustainable companies. Anyone thinks that Patagonia is sustainable doesn't understand business, doesn't understand the world. There are no sustainable companies. All we have is a path towards sustainability. That's all we have. And so you need to take that in. And here's the thing. When you look at all those values right there, you make your decisions through a strategic lens of taking those values into account. It doesn't matter where your stakeholders are, if they're tree huggers, if they're on the other side of it, if they're just financial people, if they know you went through a process to make your strategic decisions, they'll support it. This is Yvon Chouinard, Patagonia. We did a study from the very beginning, every year, the 6 years I was there. And we went from not being on Fortune's list to being the 15th best company in the world to work for while I was there. The number one factor for global employees, this is not just North American employees, was personal alignment with the company's values. Number one, Japan, Europe, South America, North America. And it didn't matter if you were working on the factory floor or you were a designer in the corporate office in Ventura. This is the number one factor, a factor analysis that drove the regression analysis. Number one is fun, being able to have fun at work, being able to have some creativity. Not telling me this is exactly how you do this job. You say I need 30 shirts folded. You don't tell them exactly, here's what we've learned. Here's the best way to do it. If you come up with a better way, great. But creativity in your work from wherever you are, that was number one. Feedback, making sure no matter who, where you are, what level you are, wherever you are, whether you're a student, you have a business or whatever, giving people feedback. Thank you. That was incredible. Sometimes just that alone. We all know so many people don't do that part. Recognition, work-life balance, relationship with coworkers, accessibility of management. These were the key drivers of our success on the Fortune survey, and it drove our job satisfaction. And ended up on Fortune magazine's cover, from being for sale 6 years previously to the coolest company on the planet. So this is something I wanted to talk about, a failure. And failures are always really powerful. So after I left Patagonia, I co-founded a venture capital firm with Steve Case. And one of the companies that we started, bought, was called Lime, a media company. And we went, since I was the smartest guy in the room, and I had learned all those things from everything I just told you about, this is a can't-miss strategy. So we looked at it. We had linear programming. We had on-demand. We had online, satellite radio. We had resorts, home entertainment, subscription, product services, alerts, websites. We had buses painted green in New York City. We had it all. We're buying traffic like crazy on the internet. We understood where we sat in the landscape, what we were going after, what their values were, balance, integrity, freshness, all these great words, to build a community of people interested in living a greener, healthier, more balanced lifestyle. Can't go wrong, right? We're just like, we got it all. Everything that we've learned, everything that I've talked about in this 10 minutes so far, everything. I mean, just segmented values, our attributes, line positioning, who we were. We did it all. We spent $23 million doing all of this. And it was a complete failure. We ended up selling it for $1 million. And the only reason we were able to sell it for $1 million was because we sold it to another company of ours that we own 40% of. It was worth nothing. And this is, you know, a lesson I'd really like to leave with you, and it's probably one of the best lessons I ever learned, is that you have to have a strong point of view. The reason you can have four generations, or how many generations is two four-generation companies, the reason you can do that is because you're passing those values along. It starts when you're this tall. You're that tall. Those values are inculcated into you. It's a part of who you are. Values and ethics are everything with these multi-generational businesses. Any great business where you have a customer's willingness to pay, actually pay more than they could get it for someone else, they're buying something that they truly believe in and they have an emotional connection to. My last company was Prana, and that's where we did do it right. Took this one over in 09. It was a $16 million company at that time. It was bankrupt. It was during the financial crisis. And this was a five-year plan that we put together based on a lot of those learnings and having a point of view. And that was a very successful liquidity event into Colombia recently. So in conclusion, superhero brands have a story, a point of view based on their deeply held values, and they have stakeholders that are so loyal, nothing can stop them from supporting the brand. Thank you. So we'll have microphones on both sides of the room. We really want to get some questions going and get some interaction with the audience. I'd just like to maybe start it off by on the values issue, and just start with, because I really don't know. I'd really like to know, maybe you can start, what are the values of is there a kind of consistent theme of values for a NASCAR customer? I mean, you almost have two customers, right? You have an advertising model on one side, and then you have the fans on the other side. You have to keep both happy to be successful. So that's a little bit different, sort of that Jordan and I have to work for. So does that make the values proposition a little bit more difficult?
I don't know if I'd describe it as difficult, but you know, as I touched on in the presentation, you always have to try to figure out how to maintain your base. You can't lose your base. So even as you're chasing, you know, new partners or new business associates, you have to figure out how to keep the ones who are already there that are loyal to you from leaving. So as Jordan certainly can attest, the hardest thing to do is find, you know, a new partner, a new customer. It's much easier to find somebody who was a customer previously. So we actually have a program within NASCAR that's focused on lapsed fans. So who are the people who were one-time NASCAR fans who have left? And they were at one point loyal and moved on. Was it because of financial situation, because we were hit really hard with the recession more than any other sport, because we are so reliant on sponsors? We lost a lot of fans who weren't able to continue to consume our sport like before. So our focus has been on trying to get them back. And you only do that if you've remained authentic through the process. So this, you know, a sport like basketball has had to adjust over time.
Most of you are too young to remember the days where the NBA was considered a disaster and all the athletes, you know, were just unbelievably hard to follow. They think the sport was going to go into the toilet, and David Stern built that product up to a place where it was wildly successful and continues to be successful. We have had similar downturns, and the way to continue to keep our customers is to not forget the past. It's not by default that we talk about our history, because even our newest, youngest fans kind of appreciate the authenticity that we brought. So the University of Oregon is renowned now as a brand in sports because of the football program and now the basketball program. And what was the biggest thing that people took away from who was outside of Oregon? That they were the first team in the Final Four in 1939 and come back in basketball. So that was what helped them tell their story, tell our story. So again, I think authenticity is the most important thing, Michael, because if you move off of that, if you start doing things that put you outside the bounds, it's hard to get back.
So you think that the bad boy image of moonshiners is what's authentic?
We don't run away from it. So bad boys are good, but we also love to impact. So we have, it's interesting. So
you're evolving.
You're evolving. So I'll give you a perfect example. Kyle Busch would be considered the ultimate bad boy in our sport. In fact, there's an amazing video of him walking down the road 3 weeks ago looking for Joey Logano and throwing a haymaker at him, you know? And that blew up for us, okay? So we were actually okay because within competition, it breeds comfort. He wants to win so bad. And yet, he's walking down pit road with the M&Ms on his chest, right? So the juxtaposition of his brand being those cute little M&Ms. So he actually has to work that fine line because Mars, which is the parent company of M&Ms, they're projecting a brand. So he has to figure out a way to associate that. So what's evolving now is that there's that back and forth. We struggle because we want our drivers to be more authentic, and we've put some restrictions. 5-10 years ago, we were probably more likely to find somebody, and now we're trying to make sure, like, be yourself. Don't go outside the bounds. This kid, here wearing a Roger Federer cap, he built his brand on authenticity. And when I worked at the ATP, we dug deep to find out what was it that he loved. And what he loved was fashion. And to this day, he's remaining true to his brand attributes and was on the cover of GQ this month. So we started a program built around him 15 years ago that still today exists. And that's why you have four generations of a family that's successful, because if you stay true to your brand, you will be able to be successful. Again, I'm sorry to talk too much, but we also have to evolve, right? So we evolved this year where we're actually doing stage racing. So instead of racing for 400 miles from green flag to checker flag, we actually stop twice during a race. That is the equivalent in our sport as the NBA putting in a 24-second clock or a three-point line. It is that fundamentally different. And our core fan was struggling with it initially. But we have stayed true to it, and we're starting to see by listening and hearing and showing them what is there, and the fact that actually the sport has always had heat racing, stage racing, segment racing, that you can evolve. Because the reality is you can't have a 3-hour race. You have to have breaks.
So let me follow the evolution thread here. So Jordan, I mean, Diane asked, so you can't just say, oh, we're fourth generation and my dad knew your dad. At some point, you have to, like Patagonia, we hit the wall with that because we didn't have the right product. So you've obviously done a lot with your business in order to evolve it. And it seems like juxtaposition because it's industrial sales. But there's no way you're doing the business now the same way you did 10 years ago. So what are you doing to evolve
and making sure that you stay on top, because everyone's gunning at you, and they've had, what, 40, how many years to look at what you're doing and to try to beat you.
Sure.
But you're still winning. How are you doing that?
You know, the major evolution in our family business really happened with my father. My grandfather had stepped into being a Caterpillar dealer and got very comfortable with that. And he grew the business in geographic size, but he didn't diversify the business. My father was the one who really dove in and diversified the business and said, okay, we're going to get multiple revenue points because there's too much cyclicality in just being a cat tractor dealer in Southern Oregon. So he got into aircraft and then forklifts and then trucks and ditch witching and all these other things. And at the time, it was much more of a stability play. But as we built it out, it's really been in the last 15 years that we've been able to put together more of the end-to-end solution bent. And that is an evolution from my perspective that is a bigger deal. It is touching customers multiple ways. For those of you who are familiar with the banking environment, you have a bank and they can provide you credit, they can provide you credit cards, they can provide you checking and treasury services, right? And so they're all coming and trying to sell service. For us, it's very much the same way. We're still a people business. Ultimately, when somebody buys equipment from us, they're buying it because they want to do business with their guy, their gal, right? Because they know when they invest that much money, you know, $500,000 for a combine is a lot for a farming family. When they invest that kind of money, they want to know that they can pick up the phone when there's a problem and find somebody that's willing to help them. So we're still very fundamentally a people-driven company, but really in the last 5 years, we have gone from being a growth dealership company to being a cross-selling company that is touching customers in multiple ways and trying to get more of the value chain and selling Papé as a brand so that in the West, people aren't looking for a CAT or a John Deere or a Toyota forklift. In the West, more and more we're finding, I do business with Papé. They can take care of me.
Let's open up to questions.
Please. Hello, my name is Xiao, and my question is specifically directed towards David. And before I ask my question, I just wanted to say that I thought the bicycle commercial was really inspiring and made me want to be a NASCAR fan. However, my question is, what is your message to customers in their 20s? I noticed on your slides it said that the average customer was aged 48. And Michael talked a little bit about the four quadrants of sustainable successful business, and one of those was environmental stewardship. And my question is, how does NASCAR feed into environmental stewardship, and how is NASCAR doing that successfully, or are they doing it successfully?
Yeah, it's a good question. We have invested pretty significantly in our NASCAR green program, and ultimately are now the biggest recycler in all sports. So we have an amazing footprint. When you come into Sonoma, or you go into a Bristol, Tennessee, you go into Chicago or Miami, you're talking about 80 to 120,000 fans. So what we've done is made it contingent upon being partners with us, these track facilities, to make sure that they have a sustainability program that allows for recycling. That we're talking about recycling not only, Coca-Cola cans and Pepsi cans and Monster Energy drink cans, but we're talking about oils and gas and fumes. And so we ultimately have a much smaller footprint than most people would expect. So we go back to them with facts. In fact, we're relaunching our NASCAR Green website, and it's going to be almost completely a numbers site so that people will see. And we're not just hiding behind, a marketing position, but that we have real numbers to go against that. We have also found in the last 5 years that every partner who wants to be involved with us needs to have that piece. So they need to be able to say that what they're doing from an environmental perspective and what we're doing. And we've found that we're getting more of those companies coming in than ever before. We have a track in Pocono that is completely powered by solar energy. It's the biggest solar energy farm in that part of the country. So we've made steps in that direction, knowing that it's going to be more important to you than it was to that 48-year-old thing you mentioned earlier. And as Michael touched on before, that doesn't mean we lead with it. In fact, we find that that's something that's more about the discussion on a B2B perspective, business to business, than it is kind of a consumer B2C, business to consumer. So we used to go out with a lot of commercials and all that stuff, and we found that that wasn't necessarily an important thing, as long as our partners knew what we were doing, and the fans would track and see that we were committed to it.
You came up with it.
My name is Mike Canal. I'm an MBA student. My question is for Jordan. We first heard last year in MC's leadership class about this vision for end-to-end integration. And thinking about Papé as a services company, I guess I'm curious how you picked which verticals you were going to grow into as you, like, first, as you contemplated sort of end-to-end all the way from Highland wheat to the bread at the Costco store. And because I'm MBA, I'm going to humor myself with a second question, which is, in light of some of the climate change and environmental change that we're sort of talking about, we're seeing that we've talked about here, what sort of planning is Papé doing as a company that does a lot of work both in agriculture and then now obviously in defense and in Navy stuff as well? How is climate change going to affect you guys?
Sure, great. So getting to the end-to-end message really started out, as I mentioned earlier, out of necessity. So we started as a cat tractor dealership in Southern Oregon, helping to build the I-5 roadways and involved in forestry. But as I-5 got built out, and as forestry was as cyclical as it was, we needed to get into other business lines. Our first one was to get into forklifts and then so on and so forth. So we were more opportunistic in the beginning, because in the dealership world, somebody owns a right to a territory. So you have to find the opportunity to get into that territory, and you have to be patient to get with the right partner. We had, in time, tried to put together deals with manufacturers that weren't the right partners. And so, as an example, there are some heavy truck dealers that are meant to be more like 10 speeds. They haul very inexpensively across the flatlands of the Midwest. But they are not built to climb into the mountains in Oregon and help on the bottom side. So what we really had to do was be patient in building our verticals and opportunistic in what was coming up, as opposed to being able to sit back and say, I'm going to pick this year to enter the truck market. And when the right opportunities came up, then we jumped on them. And we both have to maintain a reputation with our customers, but also with our manufacturers. And so then that leads to our manufacturers looking back to us and saying, hey, this company knows what it's doing, and we will allow them to continue to be a consolidated company. Through that, and being opportunistic, we then got into the early 2010s and realized what was making us unique was we were now on a pivotal point as we entered into the ag side of the business, where there was no other manufacturer who could claim to provide what we as a dealer could put together. So we evolved into it and are beginning to promote it more and more and more, and our sales teams are finding the cross-sales opportunity. So a little more opportunistic than pure planning, where if you're a manufacturer, you can pick a segment to get into. And then on the environmental stewardship side, it's multi-level. So our manufacturers are all either required by law to be focused on environmental stewardship, or because of a customer brand perspective that they want to have, they're entering into it free. So John Deere is an example on the agriculture side of our business. If you're laying down fertilizer, there's two things that you need to be aware of. Fertilizer, one, isn't particularly grand for the environment, although you need it for your crops, depending on which one you're using, but it's expensive, right? So if you can design a tractor that reduces the farmer's need for fertilizer because it has the technology, we're a drone sales company.
Ryan Drucker family kicking and screaming, or at least one family member kicking and screaming, into the drone sales business. And so you do flyovers now that look at the crops, and it will tell you where you're overwatering, where you're underwatering, and where you're over-fertilizing and where you're under-fertilizing, where you're overseeding and where you're underseeding. So with that information, our farmers then can make intelligent choices. They can change their fertilizing plan, they can change their watering plan, and that's all better for the environment. Kenworth, the truck company, through law, we've gone through multiple tiers of engines to the point now where tier four engines on semi-trucks are actually acting as air filters. So as they drive around, they emit less carbon than they absorb. So they're using the air intakes and urea extensions, slamming it together in a catalytic process, and then trapping it in a filter. And so now, semi-trucks that everybody looked at, so these are hugely fuel inefficient, and they're putting up all this CO2 in the air. They still need to get more fuel efficient, but they are less carbon, they have less of a carbon footprint than they are actually taking in environments like Los Angeles. So those are unique. And then it goes on to pieces that you were just talking about. Four of Kenworth's factories are on a path to get to zero landfill out of the factory. So one of them has attained it up in Canada. Go figure, those guys are on their game for dream work. But you know, four of them are on a pathway that gets measured to zero emissions. So that means anything, any part that gets created in, it all has to be in recyclable packages, or it needs to be on crates that can be reused and resent back to their provider, even down to the break room where they have recycling and shoot for no landfill.
I'll actually add on to that because, you know, when we actually were approached by ethanol to potentially fuel our car. So we actually have maintained probably one of our known, but important sponsorships and partnerships is with the Corn Growers Association through ethanol. So anybody want to take a gander why ethanol is knocking on our door when they first started out there selling their product? He touched on it. It's performance. So people were like, I'm not going to put this into my car. It's a less successful product. Why would we, you know, it's watered down gas, for lack of a better description. So they came to us because we wanted to demonstrate that the best drivers with the coolest cars that are going 180 miles an hour for 3 hours can perform. And ethanol went from flatlining for several years to there. Through Sunoco, through partnerships, and it was because we proved for a performance perspective. So a lot of the brands that come to us are looking to demonstrate that they're a performance brand. And that's what a lot of, that's why you see in sports, brands associating with what are considered high performance.
So Tesla's a big customer of ours. When are you going to let the battery power go?
Exactly. It's an ongoing challenge. I mean, look what happened with Tesla. They just passed GM.
Ford.
And Ford. And we have three brands in our sport, Ford, Chevy, and Toyota. And people are asking, when is that going to happen? We have to be ahead of it, so we're looking at it. How do we be part of it? Because the OEMs, which is the acronym, sports people love acronyms, original engine manufacturers, the auto manufacturers, are moving into this space.
You need to put Danica in the first battery car and have it
take off mile an hour, put it on the pole. Thank you, Elon.
Another question.
Yeah, he actually wasn't just going to do the video. He actually had a question.
Yeah, I'm sorry. I didn't get cut off this time. So I guess my main question is I feel like it's probably the typical choice that you have to make is when you're going through environmental sustainability compared to profits. Curious, I guess this is more direct to any of you, because I know as Patagonia, I know it's one of its core values is the environmental sustainability. As well as how big of an ask are you guys do a lot of stuff for environmental sustainability. I'm curious, where do you kind of draw the line between economic sustainability, environmental sustainability and the bottom line? Because I feel like there's a lot of room where it's not government regulation, it's you guys making the conscious decision to be more environmentally friendly or more sustainable. And I feel like, or at least I would assume that a lot of those decisions result in higher costs for you guys, higher costs. So I'm curious where you kind of draw the line between environmental sustainability.
So the thing that, again, I just want to reemphasize that there aren't any sustainable companies. You know, if you think Patagonia is a great environmental company, then you have to ask yourself, why are we selling the Gore-Tex jackets that lost 10,000 years in a landfill when they were thrown out? So it's the reason is because they're a great product, and when you're climbing K2, you've got to have the right product or you're going to die. And so there's always, to answer your question specifically, there's a tragedy of choice. We could all answer this. Because every strategic decision we make is, as a CEO, as a board of directors, is you have a tension between your values. The financials, as you point out, the product or service quality, whatever that might be, corporate social responsibility, and the decisions that you make as a corporation are very rarely ever in the middle of all those values. Sometimes you make a decision that's financial, sometimes you make a decision as product. It's very, very specific. What's important, and I think what I'm hearing here between these two leaders, is that there's an evolution happening. We see what's happening with sustainability. They're making amends to hit that 20-year-old down the road because they know that 48-year-old is going to be 49, it's going to be 50, it's going to be 51. It's not, the consumption is going to start to go down. And so you have to build those things into what your strategic plan is. But there's always a tragedy of choice with these decisions. And it's not easy to say, oh, we're going to be a sustainable company. Anybody that does that, we're going to be a sustainable company, there's a very good chance that they're not going to be in business very long if that's how they make all their strategic decisions. And in fact, that's how Patagonia was making their decisions, and that's why we were not doing well financially and why we were for sale. I don't mean to squash the question at all. I just want to give you the reality of being in our chairs up here and dealing with running, you know, a large corporation.
The financials are obviously critical, so I'll give you an example. I'm sitting right here, the Monster Energy. So we now are, our premier series is the Monster Energy NASCAR Cup Series. And for the last 14 years, we've been Sprint. And we had another brand that was much more aligned with kind of the core values of NASCAR than Monster Energy. And we went with them because this was an opportunity to take, we took less money because we knew for growth potential, being associated with a more young, multicultural brand was going to pay off. Not immediately, but 3, 5, 7, 9 years down the road. Now, the bean counters in our organization were not happy. In France, who's been around for a long time, was like, what are we doing here? But he's still on the Forbes list, valued at $2 billion a couple of weeks ago, so he's okay. But those are tough decisions. I mean, it is tough to go into a room and say, listen, we're actually going to take less money, but it's a brand we feel has growth potential. And he talked about that earlier with Caterpillar, right? So they moved away from Caterpillar because the potential to grow with different brands was going to make a difference. So that factors in financials, the sustainability, the community relations, all of that. And we're having to make those tough decisions every single day. You know, it's tough. North Carolina, where NASCAR's teams are all based, we've had to deal with, you know, HP2 and some of the controversy around some of that stuff. So you have to make decisions in terms of where you get aligned and where you don't. And it impacts pretty much every business you're involved. And you have, George, a tricky one, right? Because you have companies that want to come in and be part of the pay group, and you have to protect those four letters, right?
Yeah. So where I would separate it, though, is I would say, okay, if we can call it a two-part question, right? How do you address environmental concerns and how do you address sustainability? The sustainability piece is more of a layup for me because how I would define that is, I want this to be a business that continues to go on for generations because that keeps our employees employed and I never have to show up to somebody and say, I'm really sorry I made that decision, but you don't have a job, right? So From a sustainability standpoint, I want the company to be around. I want our members to be employed. I want them to have upward mobility, be able to care for their families. I want them to have health care. Those are the sustainability pieces that I think about that are separate from the environmental. The environmental piece is just profitable to be more environmentally conscious. If you can spend less money on oil, you should do that, right? And that's less of a carbon footprint. If you can replace your light bulbs, and fortunately, four generations in, we can make longer term decisions about going through a warehouse and replacing all of the lighting schemes with longer lasting light bulb solutions, right? Because we plan to be here 30 years from now and 20 years from now, and we can make those long term decisions, as opposed to a startup. And this is a challenge that you guys are gonna have to really face. When you're a startup, you don't always have the luxury of making the 8-year play. You have to go buy the 50-cent light bulb, even if it's gonna burn out in a year, because that's what you can afford to do, right? So you all had it much harder than we do making long-term decisions because, as my father used to say, my mother and father came back from Asia, and he said, you know, the big difference between the Chinese and us is we're trying to always figure out what's happening in the next quarter, and they're trying to figure out what's happening in the next generation. So we need to think generationally, not quarterly. That makes it easier for us to make some of the investments.
I love that. Just a quick comment. So I know some of you are involved with Patagonia Warmware for recycle and fix outdoor clothing. I believe you guys started rebuilding tractors instead of selling people new ones quite a while ago.
Absolutely. I mean, rebuild parts was a big piece early on, and why? Because it's just a whole lot less expensive to rebuild a transmission than to go and buy a new transmission. So if you can rebuild it, then the challenge is working with your manufacturer. It is not less expensive for the manufacturer to build a transmission that can be easily rebuilt. So that takes pressure that the dealers typically apply back up to the manufacturers to say, hey, we need you to design your product in a way that allows us to efficiently, effectively reutilize major long-lasting parts.
That's the ultimate sustainability, is reusing something like that. Because they could not do that, and you could sell another new tractor to somebody.
Yeah, but in fairness, my halo is not so golden. It's not because we didn't want to fill up the landfills. It's because we didn't want to spend the money. And neither did our customers. You can be environmentally friendly because it's profitable.
Hello, I'm Andrew. You mentioned thinking long-term, like the Chinese mentioned, generational. With innovation and labor going away, what opportunities are there going to be for us, and where should we put our energy?
It's a great question. We're a services company, so since we are not in manufacturing where things can easily be replaced by robots, I can't send out anytime in the near event horizon an Uber sale. I can't just, some autonomous vehicle shows up and delivers you a tractor you didn't order. So, work for companies like ours. Come in and be a service-related industry where you go out and build relationships, and based on those relationships, you can be transactional. In our world, we talk about sales again. When I got my MBA at the University of Oregon, the classes were full of people who came to get their MBA because they didn't want to be in sales anymore, right? Which to me is preposterous, and maybe it's because I've only got a tunnel vision in our company. But in our company, that is the quintessential entrepreneur. You get to go out and build relationships, sell large equipment, make commission off that equipment, and the more relationships you can sell, you can make, and the more equipment you can sell, the larger your bottom line is. So you're John Smith Co. if you're in our business selling. So we're big proponents of that. And on the technician side, there's an evolution that's been happening. First out of the car dealership side of the business, and we're trying to figure out technologically how to make it work in tractors and trucks. But basically it shifts it around from you come in as a technician and you're earning $20 an hour to you come in as a technician, and if you can beat the flat rates, you can keep a portion of the difference. Right now, all of a sudden, at a technical level, you can go out and be an entrepreneur and go and be efficient, be effective, build your business, and be more profitable than the technician of my father's generation who came in and punched a clock at $20 an hour.
Go up here. She's been holding her hand up for a while.
Thank you. My name is Megan. This question is for David. Well, first of all, I wanted to say that I really liked the second advertisement for your show. Super relatable. Everyone, I can definitely remember trying to raise my sibling. So my question is, how does your experience with the LPGA and tennis influence the future of NASCAR as it goes towards a first and gender neutral sport?
So one of the things that I found that was interesting when I got to NASCAR was, you know, couldn't imagine that they would hire somebody who just spent the last 2.5 years working in women's golf. You know, obviously very testosterone, speed, fast, big crowds. Women's golf, much more of a, you know, very small scale, limited TV product success. But where they have built their product is on that customer relation. Their most important day of an event is actually on the Wednesday before the event starts on Thursday, because that's when they do the pro-ams. So the pro-ams are when the actual players get to meet with the sponsors and play golf. That's where they built their brand. Similarly, even though NASCAR is a bigger scale, the success of our company is not the big brand stuff you see on the TV and even on the fire suits. It's our Fuel for Business program, which I'll talk about tomorrow in class. It is basically, we have all these brands and they want to connect with each other. So FedEx is on Joe Gibbs Racing's number 11 car, and they get massive brand exposure through all the metrics in our sport. But they've renewed with Joe Gibbs Racing with his driver, Denny Hamlin, because they get to Fortune 500 companies and have them switch from UPS to FedEx. It's a very simple equation. So similar to what Jordan has talked about with his business. So in the LPGA, similarly, they will have the ability to connect more directly with the customer and with the partners in a way that you can't do at the PGA Tour event. So the LPGA, where women sports sometimes can compete with men, they have more touch points. They can be more relatable. You go out there and you can play on course, and 18 holes is the women, as opposed to the men who will drive it 270 yards and you gotta hit it 3 times to catch up to them. So those are the things that, you know, you have to find those attributes. As I was talking about with the dean earlier today, what are the core attributes of the business school at the University of Oregon? What are the core attributes of the Papé Group? What are the core attributes of the ATP, the LPGA Tour? When I went to the LPGA Tour and I started talking to them about international growth, they like wanted to punch me. But I come from a world of tennis where I saw the potential and the LPGA wasn't ready for it. They wanted to go from Springfield, Illinois to Corning, New York, because their players, that's all they wanted to do. And the business was in Korea. You know, that's where they needed to go. And I left, and it's really, really satisfying. It's an amazing thing in business when you actually leave a company, and then you see some of the things that you had talked about come true with you gone. That is actually really, really cool. So I've seen and that's now their signature calling card is international, and we're a bunch of broader international sports than the PGA Tour can be because of the strength of the European Tour on the men's side. And similarly with tennis, you know, doing what we did with Roger Federer, making sure he went down the Andre Agassi path of popularity and doing things as opposed to Pete Sampras, just let me play, I'm not interested in growing the sport, winning was critical. And so it's so rewarding to actually see him succeed because you're kind of there on the ground floor. I'm sure that's what you do, and that's how you retain employees, and that's, you know, how you're successful. Like pushing sometimes outside the envelope, and sometimes people will catch up. NASCAR was driven and known as the France family. It was a benevolent dictatorship. Whatever they wanted to do, they just did. And then the economy crashed in 2007, 2008, and now we're much more collaborative. And now I'm better suited for the organization now than I was when I got hired, because I was built to, I was taught the business through consensus building, which is the hardest way to get anything done. And sometimes you're fortunate, you just say, hey, this is the way we're gonna do it. But business today now is much more collaborative for you to be able to be successful.
So can you bring it back to win?
Yeah.
So that's where it was going. It's like, so you made a bold statement about being general neutral, whether it was 5, 10, or 15 years. So we heard that...
And I'll be gone from NASCAR by then.
So we heard that there's women drivers in this event we were talking about.
Yeah.
So other than that, how are women going to be... I'll just give you an example of Patagonia. Patagonia, we were in trouble because we had a boardroom full of men, and 60% of our women, our customers were women. I mean, we had to change that, and we did. And that was a huge part of how we turned the company around. I think where she was going was, okay, what are you going to do with NASCAR? It's 5 years. There's got to be more than this event you had. What else is going on for women and to get this general neutral place?
So one thing that you know, you have to be careful about is talking about groups in one, you know, one big... Women are X, or I remember when I was at the ATP, I was fortunate enough to go overseas and work out of the Monte Carlo office and build the European strategy for the sport. Well, there's no such thing as a European strategy, because what works in Spain doesn't work in Switzerland. It just doesn't. And what works in the UK does not work in France. So you really have to kind of drill deeper on that. And the same kind of with women. But we have found that more and more of the women are making decisions in terms of their spending dollars. It's just like manufacturers, right?
Right?
Who's making decisions in the Papé Group right now? It's not the guy who's running the company, by the way. So for us, there's little things. And it's actually very controversial. Jack Burton's Circle of Trust, okay? So we're actually looking and experimenting with the volume of our cars. Formula One did that 5-10 years ago. It was a disaster. Part of the reason is because we're hearing from a lot of our fans, including the women, that they want to be able to socialize more at the track, and it's hard to do that because of volume. Now our core fans, they come there for the visceral power and feel of that. But is there a way that we can do it in a way that's not that noticeable, but still allows that kind of social dynamic during a race?
We are streaming live, by the way.
Okay, so, and you also, it was interesting, Whitney Wagner, who runs the Warsaw program, so never in a million years, so she was on vacation, and I invited her to one of our races in New Hampshire, and her daughter, who was probably, 10, 11 years old, Sophie, my daughter's name too, so it's one reason why I love Whitney. Just couldn't get enough of the sport. And it was not because of who was leading and who was you know, losing. It was the colors and the fact that she was able to touch the car and the fact that she decided that Jimmy Johnson was her driver. And every lap was so important because she just honed in on that. And it's like, it's so rewarding to see, because she would have zero interest in NASCAR if she went there.
That's great.
And so you need to bring them to the product.
Okay, so I'm just guessing the tractor part of the world is also kind of men oriented, or was. Is that true? Are women becoming?
Yeah, no, I mean, absolutely. So our business, because we sell equipment that touches every single industry, you know, we've got a whole variety of how we touch folks. On the farm, my brother can attest, The mothers, the wives on a farm make a lot of decisions, right? It's not like it was probably a generation ago when the dad was making all the decisions. So there's a lot of that evolution. We had challenges in our family a generation ago when it was not seemly to send a female up onto a logging landing deep in the woods with rough individuals, right? So that wouldn't have happened. So in our family business, there were not opportunities for women. Now, my brother has one daughter, I've got two daughters. Their opportunity is far greater than it was two generations before them within our company. So both on the customer side and personally within our business and how we see women coming up through our business and being influential, but certainly the stereotypes are hard to overcome. Finding women who want to fight those stereotypes are not easy, and there are paths of lesser resistance that women who want to make it, who get it and want to make it, tend to gravitate towards. It is a lesser resistance, although I would say least resistance, for a woman to be successful selling agricultural equipment on the farm to a family than it is for women to come in on our industry and be successful being product support reps calling on heavy iron where they rely on more of the technical background. A lesser resistance for the technical women in our business are oftentimes more in the shop.
Our customers love tradition, right? We talked about. So, sorry,
no, yeah, go ahead.
And what, one of the traditions that has been in the sport for several years is the command, which is, gentlemen, start your engines. It no longer is. It's now drivers, start your engine, because of one female who came into the sport and has changed it forever. And one person can do that. You change how you present your brand. So it becomes, so we're already moving toward being gender neutral or something like that. So like the first year was tough because, you know, you brought in these celebrities to do the command and they're used to, gentlemen, start your engines. That's the tradition in NASCAR. We had James Franco and we sat him down and we said, okay, dude, you gotta say, drivers, start your engines. He goes, I got it, I got it. He goes, drivers and Danica, start your engine. She is a driver, dude. But, you know, sometimes that's what you deal with when you do this.
On that note, I'd like to conclude, and I'd like to, first of all, I'd like to thank the two student groups that really did the organizing, the Sales Club and the Entrepreneur Club, Austin and Natalie. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much for coming tonight.